This is a special report from CBS News.
Good evening. This is Walter Cronkite at CBS News headquarters in New York. Well, at its beginning, this day looked as though it might be one of armed conflict between Soviet vessels and American warships on the sea lanes leading to Cuba.
While most know about the roles of John F. Kennedy, the President of the United States, and Nikita Khrushchev, the Premier of the Soviet Union, few have ever heard of a fearful but courageous man who dared not to follow procedure in order to save the world from nuclear war. The little-known but heroic actions of Vasily Arkhipov were directly responsible for giving President Kennedy and Premier Khrushchev a way out of nuclear war. This is the story about the man who saved the world by making a smart but risky decision. This would have happened if he made the wrong decision. On someone to save its existence from vanishing, and that someone was Vasily Arkhipov. On October 1st, 1962, four Russian subs, which were the B-59, B-4, B-36, and the B-130, set sail from Sida Bay, Russia, in the Black Sea to Mariel Bay, Cuba. They were ordered to complete a mission, but the men on board didn't know what their mission was. Each submarine was armed with one nuclear torpedo, and if the torpedo were to be launched, it would start nuclear war. The nuclear torpedo is designed to track down the target and hit it, then in seconds destroying it. The nuclear torpedo that the submarines carried had the same power as the bomb dropped on Hiroshima in World War II. As commander of the whole fleet, Vasily Arkhipov would be boarding the B-59 on this mission. By the autumn of 1962, the relationship between Moscow and Washington had broken up. The two sides had hated each other, and the Soviet Union had broken its trust with the United States. President John F. Kennedy had placed nuclear missiles in Turkey and Italy that were capable of destroying the people of Moscow in just under 16 minutes. When Olga Arkhipova, widow of Vasily Arkhipov, was asked on her opinion about the placement of the US missiles, she said,
"When we found out that America had built rocket launches against us, that wasn't a pleasant thing to know. Our country wasn't preparing for any wars. It was always everyone else who was attacking us."
Throughout 1962, the Soviets had smuggled 42 mid-range nuclear missiles into Cuba that were capable of destroying Los Angeles, Washington, D.C., and New York City in just under 30 minutes. Photographic evidence was later caught and proved that there was nuclear missiles being smuggled into Cuba. The captain of the B-4 submarine said,
"If you have your missiles in Turkey, we have our missiles in Cuba. And that was the game."
Back in Russia, the submarines raised their anchors to start their journey. Inside each submarine was a top-secret cargo that only certain people were allowed to see. Each cargo had one nuclear torpedo that was capable of wiping out a whole state. The nuclear torpedo can only be launched if both the submarine's captain and political officer were both in agreement. The submarine's captain and political officer each have one half of a key that, when joined, will unlock the firing mechanism. A signal would then be transmitted to the torpedo bay. On the journey, each submarine had an envelope that says the journey destination, the orders, and their timetables. The envelope was to be opened by the captain only when they were out at sea. Under their orders, the submariners will travel 7,000 miles from the safety of the Arctic Ocean, past Scandinavia and Iceland, south into the Caribbean, where they will reinforce the secret Soviet forces in Cuba. On October 14th, the weather conditions start to change. Hurricane Ella begins to form in the Caribbean. The waves were going up to 5 to 7 meters, and the wind was making it even worse. But the B-59 sat low in the water, up to 5 meters high, and it was covered by the waves. The low cloud cover meant American spotter planes were grounded. Then on October 15th, Moscow finally made contact. They have new orders. The submarines had to hold their position in the Sargasso Sea until they got new instructions, but more time at sea meant a bigger chance of getting spotted. October 22, 1962, at 7 p.m., President John F. Kennedy went on a televised broadcast to the nation and said,
"But now further action is required, and it is underway. And these actions may only be the beginning. We will not prematurely or unnecessarily risk the course of worldwide nuclear war, in which even the fruits of victory would be ashes in our mouth. But neither will we shrink from that risk at any time it must be faced. Acting therefore in the defense of our own security and of the entire Western Hemisphere, and under the authority entrusted to me by the Constitution, as endorsed by the resolution of the Congress, I have directed that the following initial steps be taken immediately. First, to halt this offensive buildup, a strict quarantine on all offensive military equipment under shipment to Cuba is being initiated. All ships of any kind bound for Cuba, from whatever nation or port, will, if found to contain cargoes of offensive weapons, be turned back. This quarantine will be extended, if needed, to other types of cargo and carriers. We are not at this time, however, denying the necessities of life, as the Soviets attempted to do in their Berlin blockade of 1948.
President John F. Kennedy also said,
"Seventh and finally, I call upon Chairman Khrushchev to halt and eliminate this clandestine, reckless, and provocative threat to world peace and the stable relations between our two nations. I call upon him further to abandon this course of world domination and to join in an historic effort to end the perilous arms race and to transform the history of man. He has an opportunity now to move the world back from the abyss of destruction. By returning to his government's own words that it had no need to station missiles outside its own territory, and withdrawing these weapons from Cuba."
On that same day, President John F. Kennedy ordered a ring of ships to surround Cuba and the Caribbean to stop any more flow of Soviet weaponry. President John F. Kennedy also increased America's defense readiness condition from DEFCON 4 to DEFCON 3 for the first time in history. Below the waters, the submarines had been away from home for for 3.5 weeks. They felt isolated and abandoned by the Russian naval command. The radio operator of the B-59, Vadim Orlov, listened in on Miami radio stations. Because of an earlier incident with a nuclear submarine called the K-19 and its nuclear reactor malfunctioning, causing 8 men to die from radiation poisoning, the Soviet Naval Command did not allow automatic engine submarines on this mission to prevent the incident from happening again. The ocean was naturally broken down into layers of different temperatures, and these different layers break up the speed of sonar waves, making submarines impossible to track. These layers are known as isothermal layers.
"85% of the entire Atlantic fleet is now on the hunt for any vessel that might attempt to break Kennedy's blockade. Khrushchev counters Kennedy's quarantine with the threat that stopping and searching any Russian ship will be considered an act of piracy. 40 destroyers, 4 aircraft carriers, and 358 aircraft are now effectively hunting for any Soviet vessel that might be smuggling weapons."
On October 24, 1962, Kennedy pushed America's war readiness alert to DEFCON 2, and according to these ratings, the next stop was nuclear war. In the warm waters of the Sargasso Sea, the temperature inside the submarine went up, and the air conditioning stopped working. As radio operator Vadim Orlov listened in, he heard a radio signal and suddenly jumped from his seat and screamed, "Plane overhead! Plane overhead!" The battery was 35%, which meant only 6 hours were left, and then it would be dead. The situation was getting harder for the crew members. They needed to charge their battery, but there was a plane overhead. The crew members didn't know what was happening above them. Neither did they know if they had been spotted by the plane. But back in Washington, communication systems explode into life. The submarine has been spotted. As the weather was settling down, the ocean had become a stable, single body of water. There had been no more isothermal layers. The Soviets' invisibility trick to get out of detection was no longer usable. The Americans were using sonar and detecting signals to try and get a stable position of where the submarine was. At the White House, a helicopter flew in and a man walked out and rushed to the president. The man whispered in the president's ear that an American spy plane had been shot down by the Cubans using a Soviet missile that had been smuggled into Cuba. The man who had died was Major Rudolph Anderson. The president's face turned white and he said this was bad. Major Rudolph Anderson had been the first one to die in this conflict. This had brought the chance of war one step closer. His plane was found and photographed that day. Finally, the USS Coney, one of the destroyers hunting for the submarine, makes contact with the B-59. But what the Americans didn't know was that each submarine carried one nuclear torpedo capable of destroying the whole entire Atlantic fleet.
We weren't trying to kill them. We could have very easily killed that submarine. We wanted to harass it. We knew they were probably having difficulty breathing. It was hot as hell in there. It was miserable. They were cramped together, and they had been under great strain for a long time. So what we were trying to do is basically apply passive torture.
The typical response would be if he wanted to come to the surface, he would fire a flare and we would say, you're clear to surface. But that didn't happen.
The men on board the B-59 are frightened and confused. With no new orders from Moscow for over a week, the B-59 has no idea that depth charges are meant as a warning.
We dropped the 5 practice depth charges to invite the submarine.
Vasily Arkhipov had to stop this action, because he knew this was an act of madness. If he had fired the nuclear missile, both sides would have reacted and fired at each other, which would have caused the end of the world eventually. It was time to make contact with the Americans. The submariners of the B-59 finally breathed fresh air. The Cuban Missile Crisis was over. Thank you, Vasily Arkhipov. You are the true hero.